गाइस प्लीज चेक द चैट. यू कैन सी द स्लाइडो लिंक. स्लाइडो इज द ओनली वे वील आंसर क्वेश्चंस. ओके, दिस इज जस्ट टू कंट्रोल द केओस.
All
Thanks. So we are live. You can start.
okay. Hi guys. So welcome to lecture one of PYCK. Today's lecture will be based on basics of Python. Before we start, I just want to inform that make sure you have registered on the Safe app for the course, because we will be using that to certify you, and you have to get 60% attendance, and we are tracking the attendance through Safe. Okay. I hope by now all of you have installed Anaconda or some other Python version and set up Jupyter notebooks on your systems. I would appreciate if you try to follow along with me while I'm coding in this lecture. Sometimes, like, I might go a bit too fast, but that will only be for places where you can just read the code and understand, but don't need to write. But if you're ever confused about anything, just keep a Jupyter notebook open for yourself and just type the same code, see what happens. If you have any doubts, just put it up on Slido. Okay, so with that, let's start the session. So this is all that we are going to be discussing today. So we are discussing comments, printing, variables, mathematical operators, lists. Then we'll have a safe quiz. Then we'll have tuples, dictionaries, logical operators, loops, and how to take input from user. So all of this is pretty basic stuff, and we are covering a lot of this in one lecture so that we can get this basic stuff out of the way and explore more cool stuff in later lectures. Okay, so let's just start off with the main. So this talks about how you have to type so much to do very simple stuff in Java, but in Python it's pretty simple, just a few lines of code. Okay, so let us first start with comments. So because comments are used pretty ubiquitously, and you will also, like, it is generally a good habit to keep writing comments as you go through the program, so that when someone else reads your program, they are able to understand what you are trying to convey through your code. It's generally, like, not very easy to just follow someone else's code, but when there are comments, it helps a lot. So before we actually go through the session, I'll open my Jupyter notebook so we can follow along. Okay, so there was some confusion about how to open Jupyter notebook. One thing you could do is Anaconda Navigator. This was covered in the previous lecture, that you could open this and open Jupyter notebook. But the thing is, you can open Jupyter notebook right from here. Just type Jupyter notebook in your search bar. This will initialize, and the notebook will open in your default home directory. Okay, now suppose you don't want to open it in your default home directory. You can change the directory from inside too, but there's another way to open Jupyter notebook. That would be, suppose I want to open it in this folder, PYCK lecture one. So I open a terminal here, or I open it anywhere, and I navigate to here. And then once I do that, I just type Jupyter notebook. Okay, so I have my Jupyter notebook. I'll create a new Python 3 notebook, and voila, I have that. So let me just check if everything is working. My kernel is ready by printing "Hello World." It works. Okay. So let us start off with comments. So let me just in. Okay, so single line comments, these are what you will mostly use. So say this is a comment, and let me just do this code. So these work same as comments in C++. So in C++, you write comments like this. You do this and you write something. So this is a comment in C++, but in Python, every comment begins with a hash. If you want to write like two comments, another hash, write whatever comment you want. What the comment tells the, like whenever the Python interpreter sees this hash in front of any line, it just ignores the rest of that line. It doesn't read it. Okay, so as far as the interpreter is concerned, this line is not in the program. But if you want to put some text in your program or tell a reader what your program is doing. So like, I'm printing hello world in this cell. Okay, so I want to tell you that I am printing hello world in this cell. So that's why I'll add a comment. So it's generally a very good practice to add comments. So this is how you do single line comments. Multi-line comments are also something that is used. So suppose I want to do the same thing, but I want to write a very big comment. So I will do something like this. So either three double quotes or three single quotes. As soon as you put three, Python will give you the rest three on its own. Okay, at least it works in Jupyter. In some editors, it might not automatically, but most of the IDEs and editors will do it for you. Okay, so I write, hey, this is a comment. Welcome to first lecture of UICK. Okay, so this is my comment. And then when I run the program, you see this comment did not have any effect on your program. Okay, but I have mentioned that these comments are pseudo comments. Now, why are these pseudo comments? We'll talk about this later when we actually come to strings, because what this is actually a multi-line string. Just to give you a heads up, like in actual Python programs, this won't make a difference, but in Jupyter Notebook, when I run it like this, you see it actually printed something. So this is something that you generally do not want of your comments. So that's why in this case, if I wanted to put comment at the end, I would do this. Okay. So that's about comments. Just leave this here. Okay, so now let's move to printing, because whenever we test something or whenever we like do anything like in our program, we always want to see whether if it is working correctly. So how do you check that? You always print it. So everyone knows how to print hello world because they've been doing that since lecture zero. You probably, if you have explored Python a little bit, you know that how printing works. So that's simple. In print, you can pass a string. You can pass a, say, integer. You can even pass a floating point number, 2 point, okay? All of these will be printed. And what you notice here is that it is being printed in a separate line. All of them are being, they are being printed in a separate line. But what if you wanted to print them in the same line? Okay. One option would be this. You do hello, you do 500, and you do 2.3456. So what happens in print when you pass multiple arguments? These are printed followed by default a space. Like you put them in commas as arguments, and by default, it uses space as a separator. But what if you wanted to change this? So we have printed multiple objects. Suppose, okay, let's just print this. Okay, James joined in 1981. But what if you wanted to have the print call on separate lines, but you still wanted to print this as it is? Okay, so that's where the sup keyword argument comes in handy. Okay, sup actually tells the Python like how to separate your variable. So suppose I wanted to do this. Instead of spaces, I wanted to have some different separator, like three underscores. If I do that, you see that every element between any two elements, James and joined in, I have three underscores. And between joined in and B, whatever the value of B was, which is 1981, I again have three underscores, whatever my sep was. So suppose if I add a dollar symbol here, that's what will happen. Every argument will be joined by a dollar in between. Okay. By default, it is a space if you don't give anything in the sep argument. What if you give another way? If you give none in the sep argument, then also by default you get a space. So none is like null in C++. Have null pointer in Python, that will just be none. Okay, so right now that's all you need to know about none. So that's about the sep keyword. Now what about the end keyword? Suppose you are printing different lines. So what's happening here is all of these are coming on different lines, but what if I did not want them to come on different lines? See, if I print this, all of them are on different lines, but I could do something like this. End equals, suppose I give it a single space, okay? Now just see what happens. It prints a space before hello and 500. Yeah?
Can you go a bit slower?
All right.
Yeah.
Okay. So till now, we have discussed comments. So that should be fine. It's just this part, just writing comments. It's pretty intuitive. In printing, this is the default way of printing we have used for the previous lecture and in this lecture. The new things that we have learned now is the sep keyword. What the sep keyword does is sep stands for separator. So if you want to print multiple objects, like all of these are say like arguments you are passing, each of them is an object to the print. And by default, it will print it as a like with spaces in between. But suppose you wanted to change the separator between these objects. So you can pass a custom separator here. Okay. So we are done with the custom separator. We can, if you also pass the none separator, then also by default we get spaces. Okay. That's all you need to know for the separator. Like that's all it does. Nothing fancy. Now there is something else called end. So what end will do is, You can give a custom string or anything that you want to put at the end of every print. So by default, what it does is an end gives you a new line. So after everything, you get a new line. But what if you wanted something different? Suppose I wanted just a space, but I didn't want to write everything in one call. So I will put end equal this. So once I did that, like let me just remove this. Everything is in a different line, but I add end, it's here. Now let's say I'll add end equals, say I can add any random string here too. See, so after this I have some other random string. Now what I can do here is I can again give something, say again I'll give hi. I can give a separate sep here, then I can also give a separate end here. Okay, both of them you can use at once. You don't need to use only one in one call, you can do both. So let's see what happens. So you do this, and then suppose in the end you give three underscores. So what happens? After hello, you got a space. After the print has ended, before the next print statement, you got a space. Then 500 was printed as it is. Then hi was printed as it is. But between these two, you got a separator. Separator is the dollar symbol. Okay. And after this, you have printed everything you needed to print. So just after that, you got whatever was the end. So that was printed. Before the next print call now, that underscores are printed and then you get 2.3456. This is just a regular print statement. So that is it for the sep and end ones. Okay. So I have given some examples in the notes here. You can also go through them. And the Notion page allows you to directly copy paste your examples in the Jupyter notebook. So you can try that too. So like, let's take this example. It works. Now, let us move to the next thing. Oh yeah, I forgot to say, you don't have to always put something here. So what you could do is, you can just give an empty string if you didn't want any spaces. Okay. So let me just give an empty string. See what happens. There is no space between A and B. A is 3, B is peg. So like I get 3 peg without any space. Okay. So if I give a space, then I get a space. Okay, that is it. Nothing fancy in sep and end. So once we, like now we have a hang of what's happening with the sep and end keyword arguments. So that's pretty much it with printing. That's all you will ever need to do with the print function. Okay, so before we move on to the next question, do we have any questions, Aryan?
None so far.
Not yet. the two people raised their hands. So,
guys, if you are raising your hand, instead of doing that, please go to Slido. Please ask your doubt there. Because we try to accommodate everybody's questions on Slido instead of here, because it's a little bit difficult to handle everybody in this kiosk. Yeah. Thank you.
Right. Okay. So now we come to something that you will use throughout. Like, as long as you use Python, you will be using variables. Okay. So how do variables work? So our general call would be print hello world. But what if you wanted to store hello world for repeated usage in something? So you just give a call, you just write a line, message equals hello world. And then you can reference this hello world using the label message. Okay, so let's just see how this works. So see, message is stored in hello world. Like, that's it. I have called it message. I can use message anywhere now. See, I can just call message, and message, like, this tells my interpreter that whenever I tell you that I want message, you return the string hello world to me. Okay. So variables in Python are just labels that you assign to reference the value, like to reference any value or any object. Okay. So if you have studied some other programming languages before, you generally have a habit of thinking of variables as like boxes, containers in which certain types of values can go into. So say I have integers, so I have a separate box in which I can put in integers. But it's very restrictive, because one single type of box can't take everything in it. So I cannot put a list into it or a string into it. If a box says I want integer in it, I get an integer. And that's what happens in Java and C++. G is actually wrong. So what you're doing is you're just assigning a label to this message. Okay, that's it.
Shubham, two notes. You are still a little fast. And second thing, if you can announce that how we take attendance, that would be nice, because some people are still asking about it and they joined late. So.
All right. So as announced earlier, I'm just repeating. So what we'll do is we'll take safe quizzes at some point between every lecture. At some point in between, whenever we feel like a break would be fine, we'll take a safe quiz. The quiz will have very simple questions, either from whatever was covered in this lecture or previous lecture, almost based off the lectures. So this will help you also do concept recall, and it will help us figure out who was actually attending the session. And then we'll use this information in the end to decide who to give certificates, whoever meets the 60% attendance criteria. Okay, so I will run this quiz. I've actually already, like, if you go to your safe app and open PYCK, you will actually see this quiz there. But when I give you the password, then only you'll be able to attempt it. Okay. So coming back to our session, I'll go a little slow now. So we covered what variables was. Variables are just labels you give to something. So I could give, say, A equals 5, and then B equals 9. Now, whenever I call A, my Python interpreter knows that I want the value 5. So it gives me that value. Whenever I call B, it gives me that value. Now, if I want to do 5 plus 9, which is 14, I can do A plus B too. Okay, because my interpreter knows that A is 5 and B is 9. Okay. Now, what happens if I do A was already 5, but I want to make A 10. So I can just change that value. But what is happening in the background is not like A was some box and then 5 was taken out and 10 was like replaced with 5. What's happening is actually for 10, I have just given the label. I've taken the label from 5 and I've given it to 10. Okay. So you're just giving this value 10 a label of A, like a name. 10 is some object and you're just naming it. That's it. Okay. So Python variables, like we said, do not need any explicit declaration. So like in int, you have to specify that my A will contain an int. Okay. In Python, you don't need to do that. The interpreter is very smart. It can figure out that A needs to be an integer. So it will just give you that. You can always check the type of variable using something called type. Okay. So type A. I've given it here. So it returns a variable which is passed into it. So it tells me that A is of type int. Now suppose I give it a string. Okay, see, my Python interpreter is smart. It figures out that a string has gone into that. I can also give it a float. Okay, sorry, this is 2.9. And now it tells me that, okay, your value A is of the type float. Okay, so Python can figure that out. You don't need to tell Python that A is going to contain float. And just because it is like that, then you can use the same value A to reference to multiple things. So suppose I say A equals 5 here. So right now, my A is 5. Now I say A is 10. Then A is 10. Both these values were integers, so no problem. Even in C++, you can do this. But now I say A is 2.9. In C++, it would give you an error right here. But here, it is dynamically typed. You're just shifting the label. So no error. It figures out that now A needs to be float. Earlier, A needed to be int. Okay, so that is it. So there are some rules about what you can name variables. You can't just call it anything. Okay, so variables can contain only letters, numbers, and underscores. Okay, and they can start only with a letter and underscore, but not a number. So let's just say, I can say data one equals two. Okay, but I cannot say one data equals two. It throws an error. This is an invalid token. Python will not accept this as a variable name ever. Okay, so these are just some rules you have to obey while naming your variables. So variable names cannot start with a number, but they can start with a letter or an underscore. So I can name my variable this. This is completely fine, but this is not. Okay. Now, spaces are not allowed in variable names. So if I just say data one equals two, this will again throw an error because it's invalid syntax. There's nothing joining this. So this statement does not make any sense. Okay. So again, your variables cannot have any spaces between them. So generally, when you have like words, say list of numbers, like you want to store a list here. So that's why you use underscores instead of spaces. Okay. That's why underscores are generally like used in your language. Okay. So that's how you, like, general developers use underscores. Like, it's not a rule. You can also name it like this. This is a convention. Now it's nothing, but I can call it, say, five. It's not a list, I know, but you can, this is a valid name. Okay. You can use either capital letters to differentiate words or underscores. So, yeah. This is another important thing that you need to know. Don't use important function names or Python, like keywords which are reserved by Python as your variable names. It's not like it will throw an error. It will allow you to do it, but it will really mess up your program. So let's say I generally use print to do print hello world, but now I'm saying print equals five, okay? Or like say print equals hi, okay? So that works, no error. I say print, it gives me hi. So it is working like a variable. It is a valid variable. But now, what if I want to do print hello? Won't work because now print is a string. Okay. So you need to really take care of this stuff. Otherwise, very bad things will happen and you won't know how to fix it. Now, if you're stuck like this, if you don't know what to do, just restart your kernel. Now Python has forgotten anything, like everything. Okay. Now, if you do print hello, it will work because all the variable names are wiped out. I had given some values to A here. If I call A now, Python does not know what A is because I just restarted my kernel. All of that data is not saved with Python. Okay. So that is it with the basics of variables. Now, what you can do is you don't have to do multiple lines, say X equals 1, Y equals 5. Z equals 3. Okay. No need to do this. This will work, but you can just do X comma Y comma Z equals 1 comma 5 comma 3. Okay. Now you can check print X Y Z, and I can give the separation to be something called a new line character. We'll cover all these different types of characters later, but you have seen this escape sequence before. In C++, this is what you use. It's like almost in every language backslash n is used. So if you do this, you see that X was given 1, Y was given 5, and Z was given 3. Okay. So this is something that is called multiple assignment. Okay. You are assigning multiple variables on one line. Now, how does this work? Let's just see. I gave X1 and Y5. Now, what if I wanted to swap them? Okay. I can just do Y, X. Okay. And now if I print the same thing, let's see what happens. See, X became 5 now, Y became 1. How does this work? If you do this in C++, this does not work. You can't just write X equals Y and then Y equals X, because when you do Y equals X, X was already Y. So both of them will become same. So this is not something you can do in other language, but here due to multiple assignment, you can do it, because first the right side is evaluated. So Python knows that Y is 5, so it puts 5 here. It knows that X is 1, so it puts 1 here, and then it assigns it to X and to Y. That's why you can just swap very easily in one line. Okay, that's why this is not actually swapping values, you are swapping labels. That's why I've like taken care to mention it explicitly. You are swapping labels here, not values. Okay, so now we'll move forward. Now something that we do, even in C++, that we define constants using const or something like that. So in Python, there is actually no concept of constants. Okay, so what actually a constant is a constant is a variable whose value should not change throughout the program. And then C++ and Java, if you define something as a constant, if you try to change it, it will give you an error. Okay, so in Python, there are actually no constants, but what developers do is they use capital letters. So if anywhere in the program I see something in capital letters, I know as a developer that I should not touch it. Okay, so at any other point, say doing this is now, suppose I want to give it 10. This is a big no-no. Once if I have defined this, I can do this. See, it will not throw an error, but I shouldn't do this. And if someone else reads your code also, they know as soon as they see a statement like this, that you mean to say that this value should be constant and should not be changed over the course of execution of this program. Okay. So that's why Python does not have any built-in constant types, but all Python programmers use capital letters. So what this is just a convention. It's not a real constant. Okay. But it should be treated as such. It's just a convention, but this is what you will use to indicate constants. So like say, I want my name to use my name. So I will just give Shubham and then I'll forget about this. Whenever I want to write my name anywhere, I'll just call this, but I'll never change this variable now, ever. Okay, you assign them only once. So that's it about constants. Let's move on to strings now. Now strings are like, Python is so popular because you can do a lot with strings in Python very easily, which you cannot do with any other language. So for the kind of power that Python gives you to deal with strings is why Python initially became so popular. Later, of course, there were some many other libraries to do other tasks, which was why it gained popularity. But strings was why Python started becoming popular. Okay, so let's start exploring strings. We'll also discuss some very cool advanced stuff with strings tomorrow. But right now, let's just start with strings. So this is a string, this is also a string. So in Python, it does not matter whether you use a single quote or double quote, okay? So either you use single or you use double, it does not matter. So let me just comment this out. This is a string. And this is also a string, okay? I personally prefer writing with double quotes. But see, it does not matter to Python. When I was using single quote, it gave me also single quote. But even if I'm using double quote, it will again print it with single quotes only. Because Python knows it's a string, it gives it to me as such. Okay. So that is why you have a flexibility here, either to use this or to use this. Okay. So let's take this sentence. There is something interesting in this sentence. You have both single quotes and double quotes. Okay. Now suppose I use double quotes for my string too. This confuses Python. It tells me that my string has ended here. Then it does not know what is happening here. And then there is a new string here. Okay. So if I do this, it will tell me this is invalid syntax. But if I use single quotes, Python knows now. If my string started with a single quote, it should end with a single quote. So it starts reading my sentence, not encountered a single quote. This is a double quote, it is fine. I continue, I encounter another double quote, it is fine. Now I encounter single quote, so it knows that my string is supposed to end. Okay, so once I do this, it realizes that, okay, this should work. So let's say, let me print it. Okay, sorry. Okay, so if I print it, I get these double quotes. Now, what if I wanted double quotes, but also use double quotes for this? Okay, I wanted to use double quotes for my string too, and also get double quotes inside. So what I can do is, I can use these backslash characters to escape this, to tell Python that whatever comes after this, you write as such. Okay, so Python will know to not use this double quote, and now this will work. Okay, but as soon as I remove this, see, Python is again confused. It thinks that this string has ended here itself. Okay, so don't do that. Now, same thing I can do with single quotes. Suppose I wanted single quotes inside, so I would prefer to use double quotes outside. So Python gives you this sort of a flexibility to use single quotes inside. So that is pretty much it. This is like the benefit of having two different ways to write strings. Now, what can you do with strings? Now, suppose I have some random string. Let's say Scarlett Johansson, okay? So I want to print Scarlett Johansson, but only in a lowercase or uppercase or title case. Let's see what title case does. If I just do name.title, it will make everything small other than the first letter of every word, okay? And this is how names are supposed to be written. So even if you're given the name in lowercase or any other case, if you wanted to format it properly as a name, you will use dot title, okay? So that's how that works. Now suppose I want to make it into uppercase. So I just do string dot upper. I got upper. Now suppose I wanted to do lowercase. So I'll do string dot lower, okay? And now I got everything in lowercase. So this is how you can very easily change case of these this string. But say in C++, the easiest way you could think of is probably do a for loop over this, check whether is lower or is upper, and if it is, then you just switch the case. So it is very complex, the simplest way that you can think of in C++. Now that I'm saying that is the most efficient way, that is the simplest way. Here the simplest way is the most efficient way. Okay, so that is how you...
Before learning that, can you please explain those double quotes and single quote example again? Some of the students are confused over it.
Okay, this double quote and single quote. Okay, fine. Yeah. So let me just say, I want to type this sentence. She said, he looks handsome. Okay, I want to type this sentence. So how do I type it? I generally, I prefer to wrap my strings in double quotes. Okay, but if I do this, Python thinks this is invalid because it thinks that this is my string because it started with a double quote, it ended with a double quote. So the string has ended. What is happening here? No idea. This is a new string now. Okay. So suppose I wanted a period here. This is a new string. So this has gone. But I actually wanted a sentence which looks like this. How do I do that? Easiest way is I use single quotes. Now Python knows that if my sentence starts with a single quote, my string will end with a single quote. So it will not think of these characters as belonging to the syntax of writing a string. Okay. Now, similarly, the other way, if suppose you wanted single quotes inside, you can use single quotes inside and double quotes outside. That's how that works. Now, if you wanted to use double quotes outside also, and inside also. That is when you have to tell Python explicitly that this is not a syntax of me using it as a string. This is just a part of my string. Okay. You use backslash to escape this. Escaping double quotes using backslash. This is called escaping a character. Okay. So if I do this, it works. See? I'll just print this to see how it will actually look if you print it. Again, sorry. Yeah, see, it prints pretty well. So I guess that solves your doubt. If you still have more doubts, I'm sure you can get it answered on Slido. I will move forward now. So what can happen is sometimes you will need to use variables and strings. So suppose I wanted to do something like, I know that the first name is Scarlett and last name is, okay, Johnson. Now I wanted to print the full name. So how do I do that? How do I combine these two? Okay, easiest thing would be like, I know that I can do it like this. But every time I want to do this, not do this every time. What if I want to use those variables to combine it? Of course, I can do first name plus last name. Okay. But what if I wanted to add some other string too? So this is where you use F strings whenever you want to inject a variable in a string. Okay. So suppose I can do like this. F. What does F say? F stands for format. Okay. So what it does is I can tell Python that inside these braces, whatever I write is my actual Python code that you are supposed to substitute in here. Okay. So that's it. Let's see how this string looks on itself. See, it got combined to Scarlett Johnson. It put the first name inside this brace, Scarlett. It took the space as it was from the string. It took the last name, whatever I had defined, from this ln label, and then it combined everything. Okay. So now if I store it in full name, okay. Yeah, see, spaces are not allowed. So if I do that, and now I say, now that is my new variable, I can just print it and it says Scarlett Johnson. So these are something which are F strings. Now suppose I want to say, now, from what I have learned, I will type something like this. But what if I do not want to give separate arguments? What I can do is I can make this a F string and I can give this number inside directly. So Python knows that whatever is inside this is either some variable or expression. Like general Python code, it will first evaluate whatever is inside these braces and then it will just substitute it there in the string. So see, it works as it should. That is pretty much what you do with F strings. So what we had done here, X, Y, Z. Okay. Yeah, somewhere like this. We could have used F strings to make it more Pythonic. Okay, so what you can also do is, or you can also use capital F. So small f is more conventional, but capital F is also allowed in Python. You can either use F here or you can use even capital F. So let me just display it once. If I use capital F, then also this is an F string. It works. There's no syntax error. So what I could do is I could do something like this. I can give A the value of world. So now A has become world, B has become morning. And then instead of doing this, which is what I was doing earlier, by passing many arguments, hello world, good morning, I will do this. I'll use an F string. I'll write only one string and I will tell Python where to substitute in the variables. So if I have to change something, I can change it here and the string will be automatically changed. Okay, so this is how F strings work. And like I said, that part is just evaluated as code. So you can even add math here. You can put values, you can take exponentiation. So 2* generally does exponentiation. So if I say, X equals 5 and I do X power 3, that will give me cube of 5. So 5 cube is 25. So that is what it will substitute here. Okay, But now you might ask, what if I actually want curly braces? Because if I use F strings, then it knows that whatever is inside curly braces, I should print it as is. So suppose I wanted to print the curly braces here. So I just do it like this. But see, empty expressions are not allowed. I have to put in some expression here. But what I actually wanted was curly braces. So I'll have to use it twice. Okay. Once I do that, Python knows that I actually want to print only curly braces. So it allows me to. Okay. So this is how you put, this is how you use curly braces in F strings. Okay. Now, what you need to know is, if you are working on a project which is working on Python 3.5 or earlier, F strings were not in those versions. So you cannot use F strings there. You will need to use something called format, which is pretty similar. If you look at this, first name, like all of this is same as what we did. Just here, instead of this, you leave braces empty, and then you will use the member method format. And then you will pass in the arguments in order of the braces. So this is how it works. What it will do is, it will take the first argument, it will put it in the first brace. It will take the second argument, it will look for the second brace and put it here. And then it will just combine it and give you the full name. Okay. So this is how it used to work in earlier versions of Python, but it also works in later. Like, it's not like just because we have F strings now, this thing does not work. This thing still works, but F strings are more efficient way to do this now. Okay. So that's how you use formatted strings. Now, this is something called multi-line strings. So when I discussed multi-line comments, I said that they are pseudo comments, not actual comments, which is why, suppose I want to say something that, let me just say this. S equals. This is a multi-line string. As soon as I put in three double quotes, it got me the three double quotes again. Now I can just type hello. Okay. And now if I print S, it will print everything on a new line. Yeah, hi. Is there a doubt?
No, you may continue. I think there was some disturbance for a couple of seconds, but I think it's fine. Yeah.
All right. Okay. So I'll continue. So how multi-line strings actually work is, you can use spaces as it is here. So I cannot use spaces in normal string. So I cannot write the same string as this. Okay, this won't work. Because this string started here, so it should end on the same line. And if I press enter, it does not work as a new line. Okay, but in multi-line strings, it does. Okay, so that's why you can use multi-line strings to actually write very long paragraphs or copy paste long paragraphs, and they will automatically be formatted as strings. So if I do print S, it actually prints everything. Now you can see it also added an extra empty line here because I used enter here. If I take that away, you see it will print it properly. Like this extra line is not here. But what if I wanted to do something like this? I wanted to write it as a normal string in one line. I would write something like this. Okay. I would have to use backslash n new line characters to tell Python that I want to go to the next line. So this is easier for me to write, but on the back end, like what Python thinks I'm writing is actually this only. So it's not like you have to say everything is different on the back end. You can write differently, but Python knows that what you're actually trying to say is this. Okay. So if I directly put this in a print statement, it will work exactly what I wanted here. See? Both are the same things. So this is how multi-line comments work. Multi-line strings work. Why are these also used as comments is something like this. So what happens is, when you actually write, say, a string, the return value is also a string. So it returns the string itself. But, and in Jupyter, it is automatically rendered, even if you don't use a print statement. But what if I write some other code here, 5? Okay, it returned a string here, but now I move on to the next line because I'm not doing anything with it, this value. This is sort of ignored. So that's what was happening here in multi-line comments. This part was ignored. Okay, it's not like this part was not read by the interpreter. It was read, but it was ignored because it does not amount to anything. Okay.
Shubham? Yeah, I would just like to add that what the interpreter does is it checks the last line in the cell, and whatever the return value of that last line is, it will try to put that in the cell below. If it is not a, if there are no print statements, that is.
Yep.
These are very subtle things which you don't really need to know, but you will come across when you start using Jupyter.
Just to confirm what Aryan said, like, let's say I have two strings. This is also a string. This is also a string. And if I run this cell in Jupyter, it will only print what was in the last line. Okay. So it has ignored what has happened previously. So now if I write something else here, print hi, what happens is these two lines are completely ignored. So both of them can be used as comments. But what is actually happening is interpreter is not ignoring these lines. It is reading these lines, but it does not know what to do with it. So it is ignoring them like that. But here, these are actual comments. These are not pseudo comments, because as soon as the interpreter sees this, it completely ignores whatever's following that. Okay. That is why these are like proper comments, but these are also something that you can use as comments. Another use of this is something called doc strings, which we will introduce in one of the later lectures. This is very helpful in documentation of large projects. Okay, so that is it for multiline strings. Then these are some of the escape sequences that we have discussed. Backslash n, you all know. Single quote, I already demonstrated how to escape it. If you have to write a backslash itself, you will use this backslash backslash. And if you have to give, say, a space, like I wanted to write hello and then backslash t in world. Okay, so it will give us four spaces. This is a tab. Okay, so backslash t talks about a tab. So I have included a link here. When you go through these notes, go through this link, it has all the backslash like escape sequences that you can use. Okay, there are a lot of different complex escape sequences that might make your code very efficient if you use. So do go through it. Another thing I want to cover in strings is something called raw strings. Okay, so let's just take this example. Now what is happening here is, okay, I print the first statement. It reads this backslash t as four spaces. But what if I actually wanted backslash and I actually wanted t? Then I can use something as raw strings. What this tells Python, this r in front of us, it can be either small r or capital R, either works. It tells it that this backslash is to be interpreted as an actual backslash, like not as something that is escaping the character next to it. Okay. So if you print that, it actually prints hello from backslash t pyckt. Okay, so you can see the difference between these two calls just because I added this small r here. Okay, so you can use raw strings. This especially helps when you want to say either copy long paths, like if you are on Windows, you have paths like this d underscore and then you have backslash something, like suppose you have courses. This will work because backslash c is not wrong. Okay, backslash c is not an escape character, so it will not be read as such. But what if this was something like NOUR, like something like that? Maybe I'll say nurses. Okay, so now what will happen is it will interpret it as a new line character. So what I actually wanted was not this. So if I use raw strings, it will interpret it as such. Okay. So that is mostly how you will end up using raw strings if you ever do end up using them. What raw strings will actually do for you is it will save you the time to put in extra backslashes everywhere. Okay, so the same thing could have been accomplished by this too. If you didn't use raw strings here, you will have to use an extra backslash here to tell Python that you want to include a backslash here and not backslash n. So it prints the same thing, but when you have really long strings which have many backslash characters, using raw strings will save you a lot of time and also like typing. So that is the use of raw strings. So I will take some questions now. I think I've gone a little bit fast over strings. So are there any questions, Aryan?
As of right now, It seems that most have been answered. Dikshant, anything I might have missed?
No, everything has been covered. You can move on. I guess.
Okay.
Maybe we can take a breather and see if people want to write down some stuff. I mean, they want to try out some stuff.
Yeah. So if you want to ask some more questions, just you can post on Slido. We will love them right now. So we can just take a 1 minute break maybe.
Yeah.
All right.
We can wait for 1 minute. Maybe we can screw.
If you have some questions for me, you can put them in the chat directly. Like I'm in the chat right now, so I can answer it right away. If you're trying something on the Jupyter notebook and if it's not working or if you need to know how to do something, just ask.
Okay, maybe some comments on speed. Do you want the lecture to go faster, slower, same pace? Please tell about the F string again. List and array seem same to me. What's the key difference?
Wait for 10 minutes. We'll come to list and we will discuss it in great detail. And you will see right away what is the key difference between list and array.
Okay.
Just sorry to interrupt 1 second. Yeah. I would just recommend if you want to take one question, max to max, take that. Because there are 2 or 3 mods actively answering questions on Slido.
All right. So, okay. Sayam, you can put this question on Slido. Okay, so
we'll just have one question, which is, can you please tell about f-string again? Maybe you can explain f-string again.
Okay, so what f-string does? Okay, let me... So f-strings are like this. So when you want to insert something in the statement, but you actually don't want to break your string into multiple pieces and use the sep keyword or something to join them, or if you want to do some calculations inside the string itself, you can use f strings. So what f stands for is just format. Format the string with whatever is the outcome of the code inside these braces. Okay. So here it tells me that whatever x value is, I will cube it and substitute it wherever this brace was. Okay. Whatever this expression evaluates to, I will substitute this here. Okay. And whatever this expression x, so x evaluates to 5 because x equals 5. So I will substitute 5 here. So the output actually will be this. Okay. The cube of 5 is 125. This will be the output of this f string. So f strings make it very easy for you to write complex strings and directly substitute variables inside those strings. Variables are expressions. Okay, you can even do function calls inside this string. So let me just take, say, this. And this AB was 5. Okay, so this works. But what if I wanted everything in uppercase? I can call this inside this function. So function calls work here. Okay, see, world and warning became capital. But A and B are still what they were earlier. They have not changed. This just gave me the uppercase value of A and substituted it here. Okay, so I hope that answers your questions on F strings. I would recommend that you Google F strings and look up the official documentation on Python to gain a deeper understanding. And this is for general, not only for f strings. Whenever you want to know more about something or how exactly it works behind the scenes, or want to know what more you could do with it, or just a better understanding, do look up the documentation online. Okay, so now let us move on to some different kinds of variables. So now we have only discussed strings. That is one data type. Another data type would be, say, integer or float. This is fairly simple. No need to do any coding for this part. A equals 2, B equals 8.0. These are two integer or floating data types that Python will automatically discern that B is supposed to be float because you have given it a float value. Okay. Now, this is something interesting. These two are actually the same, but if you look at the first number, so let me just comment out the second line. If you look at the first number, just by looking at this number, you cannot say what it is. Okay. And if I say, print the age of the universe. Okay. It will give me the same one. But to make my code more readable, I can make it something like this. So as soon as I look at this number, I see that this is 14 billion because these zeros, grouping of these zeros makes it easier for me to say that this is 14 billion. And in text, you would actually like do this using 14, like you would use commas for this part. Okay. So in Python, you cannot use commas, but you can use underscores to make readability better for you. But the interpreter knows that this underscore is just for you. It does not change anything for the interpreter. So I will make universe age this. I have run this cell now. Now I will run this cell again. And you can see this is still the same number. I have defined universe age like this, but for Python, it is still the same number as was what it was if I had written it like this. Okay. So that is one cool use of underscore that you can do to make your code more readable. Okay. So another type of data type that you already know is A equals true and B equals false. Okay. In C++, TNF are generally small. In Python, the first one is capital T and capital F. This is important. Don't forget about this. Otherwise, you'll run into errors during runtime. Okay. Now we'll quickly discuss some basic mathematical operators. Addition is same exactly as it is in other languages. So is subtraction and multiplication. Now in division, there's something interesting. So in like the latest versions of Python, like in Python 3, what you do when you divide 5 by 3, even if they were integers, in C++, if you divide 5 by 3, you get 1. Like the answer is also an integer, it's truncated. But in Python, if you divide 5 by 3, you will actually get a float, 1.6667. But what if you actually wanted an integer, like whatever the floor of it was? So you use double division, like you use double slash. So this is called floor division, and it will give you the output 1. Okay. Then modulus is exactly same as what you do in C++. A modulo B will just give you the remainder, which is 2. Okay. And a double star b is just 5 to the power 3, which is 125, as we already saw earlier. So if you don't believe this code, I'll just run it for you quickly. And you can confirm that the addition of 5 and 3 is 8, subtraction is 2, multiplication is 15. Division, see, simple division gives me the exact answer, like as precise as Python can go to this. And but for floor division, it gives me the quotient. Okay, so floor division is also the quotient, and modulus is the remainder. Okay, so I guess the basic operators should be pretty clear at this point. This is the difference that I pointed out earlier, that in Python 2, the division was actually like C++, where it would give 1. Okay, but in Python 3, this gives you the actual precise answer. And A slash slash B will give you the integer division. Okay, that is it. Now we have come to lists, which is the very important part of this lecture. And somebody also had a doubt about how lists are different from arrays. And we'll see very soon just how different they are. Okay, so this looks to you like an array, just written in much simpler format than what you would do in C++. So these are the members of Beatles, the band, like if you're familiar of them. So, okay, so let me just print this. So what this tells Python, that this is just a list of numbers. What is list? List is a collection of items in a particular order. So the order matters, that I'll put John Lennon before Paul McCartney, like this order matters, just like an array. So array is an ordered collection of elements. Just like that, list is also an ordered collection of elements. But the thing is, what you can do with list, you can put anything you want into a list. Okay, the items don't have to be of the same data type. This is the first difference between list and array. One list can have elements of all kinds of data types. It can even have class objects. We'll study about classes later. It can even have class objects inside it. It can even in fact have other lists inside of it. So let me just take this example. So let me even add another list inside it. Okay. So it works. Okay. So it does not throw any error. You can have any type inside the list and it will work, because list just acts as a container, an ordered collection of objects. Well, there does not need to be any relationship between the objects themselves. Like that is not a constraint that you have in Python. Okay. Another big difference. Whenever you declare arrays in C++, you have to give a length of the array. Okay. If you use vectors, you don't need to do that. But if you use strings, you need to do that. Sorry, if you use arrays. Okay. In lists, it is again dynamic. You do not need to give any length. It will infer the length and you can even change the length later, like we will see. Okay. So we saw that the elements can be of any type. Now let us see how to actually access elements in the list. This is exactly the same as what we do in C++. So there is zero indexing. So if I want to access this, the first element of the list, what is the first element? It is John Lennon. Okay. So if I print it, exactly I'll access it. But if you want the first element, you can't use one because one is actually two. It goes like this is zero, this is one, this is two, this is three. Okay. So array of length n will have indexes from 0 to n-1. Okay. So, but what happens when you actually access an element from the list is this is returned whatever value is in there, and you can just use it as a variable now. This can, you can think of this as a new variable name, and you can do any operations on it. Like here, I wanted the third member of the Beatles, which is George Harrison, and I wanted it in lowercase. So I have used an F string. So what I'll be doing is actually for to help you recall the concepts we have learned earlier, I'll keep using those, even if it's not needed. So I've used F strings here. I have put this inside the braces. So it will first give me the third element of the list, which is a string. So this is a string. Okay. So this string comes here. Then this is string.lower. So the string will become lowercase and then it will be substituted in the string because it's an F string. So what happens here is I get another Beatles member is George Harrison, which is exactly what I was expecting. Okay. Now let us go back to our code. Now, another big important difference is, like I said, first while declaring, you don't need to know the size of the list.
Wait, Shivam, can you please zoom in a bit the screen?
Oh yeah, I can do that, I think. I guess this should work.
Yeah, it's perfect now.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, so where was I? I was here. Okay, so first I don't need to know what is the size of the list. But in C++, if I need the last element of the list, I actually have to go through the entire list to get to the last element. If I don't know the list length, but if I know the list length, I know that the list is of size 4. So the last element will be at index 3. So I can directly use Beatles 3. But in Python, you don't even need to know the length of the list. You can just say that start counting from backwards. So if you use -1 is this. You can start from here. This is -1th element. This is -2th element. This is -3th element. Now you will wonder while going forward, you have 0, 1, 2. But from going backward, you have -1, -2, -3. That's because this cannot be 0 because 0 cannot be used for two different indexes, right? That is why this is -1. So see, if I call -1, it gives me the last element. Now it's not just for the last element. You can start counting from backwards. So if I do -2, it will give me the second last. And similarly, if I want the first element, but from backwards, I can do -4, 2, and it will give me John Lennon. Okay. So that is how it works. You can index from forward as well as backward, which is a pretty big advantage of using lists. Okay. So that is okay. I will stop for a bit here. If there are any questions, do let me know. I'll have a water break.
Currently, we don't have any questions.
Okay.
It so can take a 30-second breather. Because there's a lot covered.
So if anyone has any doubt, then post on Slido. We will answer them there. Okay, so we will be having quiz after some time. They will just let you know. Just wait for a few more minutes.
Okay, let's go.
Okay, so now what we want to do is how to actually work with this list, modify this list. As you go through the program, you might need to change the elements in the list or remove something and add something. We'll learn how to do all of this right now. Okay, so you have a list of different brands of motorcycles. So Honda, Yamaha, Suzuki. Okay, now what if you want to change the first element of this list? You don't want Honda in your database anymore. You want Ducati now because maybe you have more money. So you want a more expensive bike. So you sell your Honda and you want a Ducati now. Okay, so you update it that your Honda has now become Ducati. So earlier, if I had printed motorcycles, okay, I would have had Honda, Yamaha, Suzuki. But as soon as I change the first element, now my new list has become this. Okay, it's just that easy, changing elements, and exactly same as what you did in some other language like Java or C++. Okay, so that is how you change the element. So you can actually change the elements of the list. It's not like once you have assigned it, it's a constant, now you can't change it. You can change it just by assigning it. So this is just like variable assignment. This is the variable name and this is this. Okay, now how to add an extra element to this list. Like I said, in C++ for arrays, array lengths are fixed. So once you have defined a 3-length array, you cannot add a fourth element. But in Python, it is pretty simple. If you want to add an element to the end of this list, you use something called directly the name of the list dot append. Okay, append, actually, it's just an English word, which means adding something to the end, just like add something. Okay, so append is just that. So you are appending Ducati to this list. Okay, you want to buy a fourth bike maybe. So once you do that, your original list has now become this. You have four elements now. You have successfully added an extra element in your list. But what append does is it only lets you add at the end. What if you wanted it at the first position or maybe the second position? What would you do? You can do something like this. There's something called insert. With that, you can do motorcycles.insert. And then you can tell it at what position do you want. So suppose I want it at the second position. Second position means index one. Okay, and I want Ducati there. Okay, once I do that, it's done now. Now if I look at my motorcycles, Ducati has come at position one. So Yamaha and Suzuki have shifted to the right. So earlier Yamaha was at index one, but now Yamaha is at index two. Okay, so that is how you can insert a new element in the middle, like anywhere you want inside the list. This is also, again, something that you cannot do with arrays. If you want to do this with arrays, then you will have to explicitly shift everything to the right if you have extra space in the array. If you don't have extra space, you cannot obviously change the length of the array, so you can't even add an element. Okay, so that's how you insert elements. Either you append it at the end of the list or you insert it. Okay, so now what if you want to remove elements? Okay, so maybe I'm doing bad now. I have to sell my, like I have to sell some motorcycle. So I want to delete now. Okay, so motorcycles had, I have Honda, I have a Ducati, I have a Yamaha, and I have Suzuki. Now suppose I want to sell Ducati. Okay, so I can use something called delete statement. So I can just say delete motorcycles and whatever is the index. So motorcycles one was Ducati, okay. Now let's just see what motorcycle one is. See, it is Ducati, and now I want to remove it from this list. So I can just use del. Okay. Now if I look at motorcycles again, see, Ducati is not in there anymore. Okay. Now another way to do this exact same thing is you can use something called pop. Okay. What pop will do by default? So I'll say, removed element equals motorcycles dot pop. Okay, now if you look at motorcycles, the last element of it was removed. So my motorcycle was this, the last element, which is hold on, I think what was my motorcycle earlier? Yeah, it was this. So let me just put this here. I added Ducati to my list, and then now I have to say remove Ducati again. Okay, so this was my original list. I have popped it now, and now my new list is this. So pop will do is it will remove the last element of that list. It will just pop it out of your list. Okay, but what pop actually does, it also like pops it out and returns it. So you can actually throw it inside a variable. So what you have here is removed element was Suzuki. You can actually access that. So sometimes what you want to do is you want to take elements out of the list. You want to do something with it, maybe some processing, like put it inside some function. And then after that, you have no use for that value. So you can just throw it out. So that's when you can use pop. But what pop will do is by default, it will give you only the last value of the list. But what if you want any particular value? Okay. So let's say my original list is this. Just for confusion, I'll add some extra lines. Okay, so now my original list is again this. Now I have to remove, say, Ducati. Okay, I want to remove Ducati from that my list. So I can do motorcycles.pop, and then I can give the index. So Ducati is at, say, index 1. Okay, sorry. That became markdown. Okay, so Ducati is at index 1. So I can return Ducati. Now, if you see, I can press this. I have not actually passed a variable here, but it will print it directly because it's a Jupyter notebook. So whatever is the return variable in the last line, it will automatically render it. So now Ducati has been removed. So my new list does not have Ducati in it anymore. Okay. So I was able to use pop to remove a particular element out of that list. Okay. I just popped it out. And I still have it. I didn't throw it away yet. So I can use this Ducati if I save it in some variable. Okay. So that is how pop works. So you can use delete, you can use pop. Another thing, what if you don't know the index number, but you want to remove a particular value? Okay. So you can remove an item by value. Okay. So how do you remove an item by value? Again, I have this. I want to remove Ducati from this. So I can directly tell Python to remove Ducati from this list motorcycles. Motorcycles is my list. I'm calling the function remove on it, and I'm telling it to remove Ducati. Okay, this is pretty intuitive. Now what will happen is, as you guessed, it has removed Ducati. Now, what happens is, suppose I had many Ducatis. Okay, let me just make copies of this some at random places. Okay, I had a Ducati here. I again had a Ducati here. Okay. So I had 3 Ducatis, but I tell it to remove Ducati. What it will do is it will only remove the first one. Okay. The other two ones are untouched. So remove only removes the value which it has found first. And then it stops looking. It does not check if there are other Ducatis that need to be removed. So if you want to use remove to remove all instances of a particular value inside a list, you will have to do iteration. So you'll have to use loops. We will learn about loops later in this lecture. So that is how you could use the remove method to remove all the values of a particular value. Okay, like all the elements of a particular value. So that is remove.
Shubham, after remove, maybe we can skip to slicing, because organizing and combining lists is somewhat, and we can leave that for.
All right. So, guys, let's leave this section for self-reading because it is very intuitive. Just read whatever is given in these notes. These notes will be available to you right after the lecture. So what we are doing here is we are sorting the list. So dot sort is for permanent sorting. Then you can even temporarily sort the list with the sorted function. And then if you want to say reverse the list, this is how you could reverse the list permanently. Okay. So this is organizing a list. Go through this on your own time. If you have any doubts, post it in the doubts channel. Okay. Then you have something called combining lists. I plan to leave it as a self-study thing even earlier. So you can use the plus one to combine this list directly, but this is temporary. What extend does is it will add this list to this list. If I do fruits.extend, so it will extend the list. Look into this on your own time. Okay. So now, after having covered some basic list stuff, do you have any doubts with the material that was covered till now?
I guess we can move on to the quiz.
Just a second. I'll cover slicing and statistics very fast. Okay.
We can skip statistics too. It's just very simple.
It won't take much time. You can just use this. if you have an array of numbers, if you want the max element, you can just call maximum of that array and it will directly give you 6 because that is the maximum. You can give minimum, it will print 1. And if you want the length of the array, this is a very important function that you need to call. Sometimes you want to use it as a maybe loop counter, like loop variable, or in general, if you need to know the list of array, just use len. Okay. Now let us come to another important thing, which is how lists are also very different from slices and way more useful. Slicing. Slicing is super important. So suppose I have a list of elements, but I only want to work with a subset of it. Okay. So, okay, let me not do this yet. So this was my original list. I have all these foods in this list. Now suppose I only want to work with this much of the list. Okay. So I will use something called slicing. With slicing, I have to give the first value, which is from where should I start. So I should start from the first index. And I want to go up to here. So this is 1, 2, and this is 3, but I do not want to take 3. But what Python expects is for you to give 3 here. So it will start at 1, it will go, and it will just stop before 3. So this is like not inclusive. Like suppose you can think of it in terms of intervals. So it starts at 1 and it ends at 3. Okay, so 3 is not included. So only 1 and 2 come. And let's suppose this is not a continuous interval. Bad analogy on my part. Okay, so if you do this, you only get this much part of the list. This is a slice of the list. Okay, you can think of the list as a whole and you're just taking a slice out of it. Okay, so this is very important, something called slicing. And there are a lot of things you can do with this. So suppose you wanted to slice and skip. So you don't want to take a continuous slice. You want to skip some fixed number of elements. Okay, so I want to take the whole list. This is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so if I want the whole list, I want to include 4 too. So I will pass 0 to 5. Okay, so let's just do 0 to 5. It will give me the entire slice. Now what I want to do is I want to take every second element. So if I take pizza, I want to skip falafel, and I want to take carrot cake. I want to skip cannoli, and I want to take ice cream. Okay, and now I've reached the end of the list, but I've also reached the end of whatever I'd asked it to do. So it will stop there. So now I only get every second element. Okay, you can do it with the third one too. So now you only get pizza. You skipped 2 in the middle, you did cannoli, and then you reach the end of whatever you had asked for. So it will stop. So this is how you do slicing with skipping. Pretty simple. It takes slice from index 0 to 4. So 5 is not included, and it takes every second element. Okay. Now, what if you wanted a slice from the beginning of the list or the end of the list, not the middle? So that's when you can actually skip this. Okay. So I can do this. If I do 0 to 5, it gives me the entire thing. No? So I can skip this 0. Okay. And if I wanted the first 3 elements, this is how you get the first 3 elements, or first k elements in general. I wanted the first 2 elements, I get the first 2 elements. Okay. Just that simple. Now, what if I wanted the, like, from the third element to the end of the list? So from the third element to the, okay, I'll just leave it like this. Okay, end of the list. So it started at index 3 and it went towards the end of the list. So index 3 is this, 0, 1, 2, 3. So I got cannoli and ice cream. Okay, so that's what we have. And then one thing that you might think is, what if you want the entire list? So what does this do? This tells Python to go from start to the end and take a slice out. So this actually is a copy. So you can copy the list in this way. So there are 2 ways to copy a list. So let me give you an example. 1, 2, 3. Now you might think, why can I not do directly B equals A? Okay. Now if I change A1 equals say 5. Okay. And then I print A. Now A has changed, but for some reason B has also changed. But B was supposed to be a copy of A, but not related to A anymore. So I'll have to use dot copy. Okay. Now A has changed, but B has remained the same. Another way I could do copy is, I could do a complete slice. Okay, slicing is not related to, like, the slice you take out is not related to the original list. So you can see that B has not changed anymore. So by using this code, you were able to create a copy of A by taking the complete slice out of it. Okay, so that is mostly slicing. There is only one important stuff that I wanted to cover is this skip parameter can be negative too. So you can do something like this: a this start to end, and then give minus one. So it will just reverse the list for you. This was 153, and now this is 351. Okay, so this is a temporary way to reverse the list. Earlier we saw dot reverse method, that was different. So that is pretty much it. One last thing is you can also use negative indexes. Okay, so if you want the last three elements, you would do something like this: minus three to end, and you get the last three elements. This had only three, so maybe I'll use food here. So I got the last three elements, which is carrot, cannoli, and ice cream. Okay, so let's do the quiz right now. Before, like, till I start the quiz and till you fire up your safe apps, does anyone have any questions? Like, Aryan, are there any pending questions?
No, not yet.
Okay.
Seem like it. So, people, please open your safe app. Please open your safe app. Let's start the quiz.
So guys, there are 7 questions and 2 to 3 minutes should be enough. But since this is your first actual quiz, we have given more than that time. But we'll resume with the session in 5 minutes. Okay. So should I start the quiz or is someone still getting ready?
You can start. Show them the password and then
they can start the quiz.
Okay. So the password is on the screen. This is the password. DPUUYT.
While some of you are taking the quiz, the rest, if you have any questions, feel free to ask on Slido. And some people feel that slicing can be should be covered again. So maybe we'll do that.
Some of the Slido comments have been addressed, and if you find a similar question, you can always look there. I think some of the answers on Slido are quite good. There are a couple of pinned comments, so you can find most of your answers there in the interest of time.
Okay, so in the interest of time, you guys wanted to like the slicing part to be explained again, right? So can you maybe go into a bit of detail about exactly what part, or just the concept in general?
Just the concept in general. We can just briefly go through for the two to three minutes. We can just briefly skim through them. Okay.
The main emphasis being on the three slices part. So yeah, maybe you can with that.
All right. Okay. I can do that. So, okay. Has no one submitted the quiz yet? The quiz seems to be hard. Nobody has submitted yet.
Quiz isn't getting submitted for some reason.
That's okay, so if it's stored locally, then that's not an issue. It will submit it after some time. So you can just wait for some time.
Yeah, you can chill out in the chat. You don't have to spam. It's due to the load.
Don't post it here.
It's due to the load on save, so it will...
Yeah, it will get submitted automatically. It will be saved locally. So don't worry, your record will not be lost. Just let the timer end or just click on submit. And even if it's not uploaded, it will be submitted on your local record. Okay.
You will also tally it with team's attendance. You don't have to worry.
Shubham, it will not submitted here because it's stored locally.
So can we go back to this session?
Let's wait for 4 minutes. It started 11:30. Because the 3 minutes are left, so people can try.
Okay. So can you put the password in the chat? Maybe I can get some code ready to make slicing better. Just put the password on the chat so I can move to another screen.
It is already. So, yeah.
All right.
In the chat.
Fine. Okay, so let me just define.
Just reiterating before Shubham continues, any issue at all with saves, please do not bother. We will ensure that your attendance is taken care of. So please don't post it on chat. Any kind of error you're getting, it doesn't matter. repeating myself once again, please do not spam chat. Anything happens on Sage, as long as your phone doesn't blow up, it's okay. We will account for your attendance. Even if your phone blows up, please don't put it on chat. And yeah, Shivam, I think you can start, no?
Okay, okay. Yeah, I think it's been enough time since we got started. Okay, so let us start with slicing again. This time I've taken a numerical example, so it's like easier to understand. So my list A is just a list of numbers from 0 to 19. So these are 20 elements, okay? So what slicing does is, suppose I wanted elements from 2, like the third element from index 2 to, because this is just the index. So whatever the element value is also its index. So suppose I wanted 2 to 9, okay? So I would give the slice 2 to 10, okay? So you see, I got 2 to 9 elements. I stopped just before I reach this index, okay? This index is not included in the slice, the second value, okay? So this is how the normal slicing works. Now, what if I wanted the first 10 right. elements, okay? So I don't need to give, I can give 0, that starts from 0. So I get the first 10 elements, which is 0 to 9. But even if I omit this, it still works, okay? Now, what if I wanted elements, last 10 elements? So I would say that you start counting from here. So minus 10 would be somewhere here, like this is the minus 10th element. And you start from here and you go up to the end, okay? So then you got the last 10 elements, okay? This same thing can again be written as, like, start from the element at this index and go through the end, go to the end, okay? So again, you get the same thing, exact same thing. Now, let us talk about the third argument. Now that maybe the first two arguments are clearer, let's talk about the third argument. So if I take the entire list, like this will just give me entire index. If I omit the first one, it tells me that start from the beginning. If I omit the second one, it tells me go up to the end. So if I omit both of them, it tells me start from the beginning and go to the end. So I just get a copy. Now, what I can do is, I can add a third element, which is maybe say 2, okay? So look what happens. I get all the multiples of 2. So I started from 0, I skipped one element. So I'm taking elements at a gap of 2. So I took 2, then I took 4. So by default, this is 1. So if I do 1, you get the exact same thing that you would have gotten, the entire array. But if I take 2, you get every second element, okay? Similarly, if I do 3, you get all the multiples of 3. If I do 5, you get all the multiples of 5, okay? It's just that simple. So this just tells you how many values to skip until you take the next value, okay? This is just that. Now what happens is, okay, let me just write this again like this, okay? So I have 20 elements in the list. So if I do 0 to 19, then 19th value will be skipped. Okay, so I will get only the, like I will miss out on one element. So I actually have to give 20 here. Okay, so I get the entire list. So by default, this is 1. Like even if I put 1, it doesn't change. But if I put something like 4, then I will take every 4th value. So this is exactly what slicing is. Just now, if you put negative values here, okay. So suppose you put negative 1 here, then something wrong will happen. This will give you an error. Because what you're doing is, you are starting at index 0, and then you're starting, like trying to go backward. So this does not work. But if I put 20 here and 0 here, that means start from this index, maybe I think, yeah, this will work. Okay, so start from here, and then go all the way to the back with minus 1 step. So you go this side. Instead of that side, you go this side. Okay, so again, you can skip this here. If you give the a minus number in the third position, the interpreter knows that you want to go in the other direction. So it takes that start from the end, go to the beginning, and go in this direction. So it takes the entire list, just traverses it in reverse. It starts from here and then it goes like this, all the way to the back. So that's why you have 19 to 0. That's why this is a very simple way of reversing the list. Okay, I hope that clears up slicing. If there are any doubts, ask me now, like which are pending from Slido, or we can move to the next part.
There's no more doubts. Okay. Yes, Aryan can address the rest of the.
Aryan, can you share your screen?
Yes, just a minute. Is my face visible?
Yes.
Great. I'll just share my screen. Okay. I am presenting. Somebody needs to confirm that you guys can see it.
Yes.
Okay, fine. So thank you, Shubham. That was a pretty thorough session on lists, right? So what I'll do is I'll cover tuples and maybe dictionaries. Okay. I'll see if I don't think we'll cover more than that today. So you can chill. It will not extend too much. Okay. So let's begin. Tuples. So what are tuples? Tuples are just an ordered pair of stuff. Okay. Let's say you have a tuple like this. Okay. So do that. It's called my tuple. This is how you define it. You put a bracket here, you put a bracket here, you write elements and you put a comma between them. Okay. So I'll just want to see what it looks like. It looks like this. It's a comma separated kind of it's just a comma separated kind of list. Yeah. The difference between this list and a tuple is that tuples are immutable. Now, immutability is simply this thing that values cannot change. Okay. So I'll probably show you this thing, right? So my tuple in, and let's say we have my list equals 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah. And let's see what my list looks like. Okay. Now, my tuple, if I try to change the zeroth element to 100, tuple's object does not support item assignment. Now, what does that mean? I cannot change a value on a tuple. Okay. Now, if I try to do the same thing in the list, but it did not show me an error, so I'll just see what the list looks like. So we just did it successfully in a list, right? So that's the main difference, okay? A tuple is ordered, and what that means is this element is, you have some ordering, okay? This is a zero, this is the first, this is the second element, okay? 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the zero ordering that we have, right? Same as C++. Now, how do we define a single element list? Right? We define single element list like this. For a tuple, we have to put brackets. Yeah, we put one. Okay, but if you remember in mathematics, this also looks pretty much like just, you know, those normal brackets that we have. So how do we differentiate it? We differentiate it with a comma, right? So when you put a comma and I show what T means. Voila. I have one comma and that is a tuple. Okay. I guess Shubham has gone over type. So maybe I can just print the type. Yeah, it's a tuple. Okay. Nice and easy. Okay. And I've already, so you can also have an empty tuple. Empty tuple. I'll just put that as E and I'll do this. What is E? Looks like this. Yeah, so that's what an empty tuple looks like. Now, awesome thing about tuples is they are faster than lists, right? Because tuples are immutable. So when something is immutable, its size cannot change. When its size cannot change, it turns up to be, I mean, it becomes faster because of how it's implemented internally, okay? So yeah, that's very easy. Now we have two functions here. Very simple. Dot count and dot index. Dot count gives you the number of, dot count three will give you number of threes in the tuple. Dot index one will give you the index of number one in the tuple. Get out, right? So this is my tuple. I'll redefine my tuple like 125, 242, 241, 105. Yeah, and let's see what my tuple dot count 242 is. So let's see what my tuple dot index is. That's also one. Let's take a better example. How about 100? Yeah, that's three because it's 0, 1, 2, 3. Yeah, it's very simple. It's just it's something that everybody uses in Python. It's really useful because it's immutable. You can use it to pass from functions, you know. So when we have a return type in functions, we'll go over functions later, of course. But when you have a return, when a function returns something, you can just return a tuple of stuff, right? And tuple can have different data types. So if you have tuple 2 equals 0, 1, that's fine, right? Tuple 2, this is a string, this is a number. It doesn't matter, yeah? It's super simple, no rocket science here. You can obviously do index 0 here, not a problem. Yeah, so let's move from here. It's very easy. You can even read it and get it. I just wanted to introduce it. Okay, now let's go to dictionaries. Just do that. What are dictionaries? Okay, so maybe I won't get too much into depth. I'll just try to keep it simple. Let's see what happens in a dictionary. So maybe in C++ you've heard of a map, maybe you've not. Let's try to think of it this way. What is a dictionary? What's a dictionary in the real world sense, right? So it's just that you have words and you have their meanings, okay? So when you have a word and their meaning, what you do is you look for the word and you read its adjacent meaning, okay? So in a similar manner, in a Python dictionary, you look for the key which is like the word that you're looking for. You look for the key and then you find what the value is attached to that key. Okay, so let's do this in a very, very easy example, right? So this is how you define a dictionary. Oh, sorry, this is not getting copied. I'll do this. Yeah, let's define a really simple dictionary. So this is how you define a dictionary. You write the variable name. My dict is equal to, you open the curly braces. Then you write a key. Maybe I want the key to be 100, okay? And I want a value of 100 means something. 100 means help, okay? And 200 means don't help, I guess. I made the classic blunder here. Maybe I could just, you know, use this and this. The way Shubham talked about strings, when you want to use this, you use this kind of string. Use the literal, which is double quotes, when you want a single quote, within, right? And I guess I can just do this for consistency. I'll just put. Yeah, and this is a dictionary, okay? I can have any kind of value here, any kind of value here. Int, string, int, anything, yeah? And then I can't have, you can read about what you can't have, but you can have some simple data type here, and here you can have basically any kind of object, okay? Here you can have a list. Say, help me, right? Okay, now if I want to refer to something in the dictionary, my dict 100, what does that do? It gives me what was the meaning of this word. The meaning of this word was help me the list, right? So it gave me the list. Now if I do 200, it says don't help. Okay, well, I saved this as a string, so that's what it's giving. Yeah, super simple, no rocket science. That's why I keep saying, yeah. Now, some things in the dictionary, actually, this is wrong. I might just remove it because it used to be unordered and apparently now it is ordered, a dictionary. Maybe we'll remove this later. But what's the key thing to note in this image? I hope you can see it. Can you guys see this? Dikshant or Shubham, if you can tell me if this thing is visible. Yeah. So this dictionary, it is defined as curly braces, right? And then you have some key, then you have a value with a colon, right? So we had a key and a value with a colon. Same, key, value, and a colon. And you can do the same thing with this kind of dictionary, right? So here the keys are Mickey and Donald, and the colon, and then you have a colon, and then you have a value, which is mouse and duck. Now my dictionary, and then I say Mickey, cool. Say Donald, cool. Now if I want this to say something else, like Donald Trump, right? I can set it. Okay. Dictionary is mutable. You can change the value. Cool. And what do I do now? I try to check what's inside this key. Now, let's see. Oops, it gave me Trump. Right? Really simple, and it's very useful. You do this a lot in Python. You should be using dictionaries a lot. They are somewhat efficient. Okay. Now there is a way to delete. You can read about that. Very simple again. Yeah. Now essential functions of a dictionary object, right? So let's see. Dot clear, I won't show it to you. You can simply remove all the elements if you say my dict dot clear. Now if I show you my dict. Yeah, I mean, it was really simple. That's why I showed it to you. It's okay. So if I have get, now my dict dot get, and then I put something here. So instead of my dict, which is empty, I'll just use my dictionary, okay, and get. Now it's the same thing, the way we were doing it here. We're just doing this with the dot get. Nothing's changed, okay? Dot items, well, that's one thing. Let's see what it gives us. It gives us this strange looking thing, right? What we have here is our, it's sort of like a list of tuples. Maybe you can, I'm not sure.
You can pass it inside a list constructor.
Okay, maybe I can, my bad. Maybe I can do this. So it's like a list, only thing it's a different data type. You just need to put it in this list constructor. Let's save it here. Let's put it here, right? And let's show what A is. And yeah, then you have A0 is the zeroth element of a dictionary. And A0 will give you a tuple, right? And it's always going to be a length of two tuple because key value pair, right? Remember? So yeah, we have this tuple, and then we just say A0, 0. Let's make it A0, 1. That's mouse. Okay. While that's not the best way to do it, it's one of the ways to do it. It's not going to be a problem. Yeah. Now, the way I showed you items, it gave you a list of tuples in this thing called dict items. Now, we can do the same thing with keys. That is, let's say my dictionary dot keys. Yeah, same thing again. Now I need to put it in list constructor. Gives me a list. Now these are just my keys. Okay, I want Mickey and Donald, so I got. Now, instead of keys, I do values. Exactly the same thing, just that it returns a list of all the values in the dictionary. So yeah. Same thing. Okay. It will again put it in this wrapper. We call it a wrapper when there is no real meaning to it, but just it's just something that exists. Dict values is just something that exists. There is no real meaning to it. That's why we call it a wrapper. And there is a wrapper around the values, and that is this thing called dict underscore values. Okay, we just have to put it in a list. Super simple. I hope everybody's following so far. Yeah. And let's just do my dictionary dot pop. Okay, let's, so I need to show you my dictionary first. Let's show it to you. This is what it looks like. Let's pop. So what does it say, right? It uses a key. So what key should we use? Let's say we want to pop Mickey, right? Okay, so what did that do? It gave me this this value when I popped it out. Now if I open my dictionary, right, it doesn't exist anymore. So what happened here? It basically, I dot popped the Mickey key, with it came the value, and this thing returned the value that was attached to Mickey, that is mouse. Okay, and when it returned it, it just simply printed it, because that's what happens in a Jupyter notebook. Yeah, right. And there is nothing more to it. And since we used a pop usually removes the entry. So yeah, we don't have that entry anymore. Okay, that's that. And we can create a list of dictionaries if you want, because lists can be of anything. Okay, you can create a list in a dictionary. You can create a dictionary in a dictionary. I mean, it's just, there is a lot you can do, right? Because you see, when you when I showed you this, right? I showed you this thing. So I'll just do this. I'll make this huge. I'll show you this, right? So what's happening here? We have some sort of types. Usually it's like some limited kind of types can be used in the first part, which is the key. Any kind of type can be put here, which is the value, right? The value can be another dictionary for all, for whatever my purpose is, it can be another dictionary inside here, okay? So maybe I want to put my dictionary inside this, right? It can work because it just takes anything. See, it'll print it out really beautifully, okay? That's about it in dictionaries. Are there any questions for dictionaries? I am open to it. So anything?
No, I guess
no.
We can over
it. Yeah. Okay, yeah. So
everyone is tired.
Yeah, I know, right. So guys, from relational operators, we will not cover today. 2353, not only are you guys tired, we are also tired. And I had this really good image for the end of the session. So yeah, today this is where we break. Okay, so we can stop the